would please remain standing for just the initial part of the service. Just one quick service note, you can follow along in your service folders. Additionally, if it's easier for you, you can also follow along on the worship screens. We begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We have come together to seek God's comfort in our sorrow, and to rejoice in the promise of the resurrection. Grace and peace to you from God our Father, and from the Lord Jesus Christ, who said, "Come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest." Let us pray. Lord Jesus, you wept at the grave of your friend Lazarus, and you consoled Mary and Martha in their distress. Draw near to us who mourn for Gladys, and dry the tears of all who weep. Calm our troubled hearts, dispel our doubts and fears, and lead us to praise you for having brought her to faith. In your rising from the dead, you conquered death and opened the gates of life. Strengthen us with your word, and lead us through this earthly life until at last we are united with you and all the saints in glory everlasting.
Amen.
And we'll turn to Psalm 23 as God gives some very welcome comfort there, a very familiar psalm. And please note the congregation can join at the end in the Glory Be response. The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. He causes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You set a table for me in the presence of my foes. You drench my head with oil. My cup is overflowing. Surely goodness and mercy will pursue me all the days of my life, and I will live in the house of the Lord forever. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Congregation may be seated. We'll sing our first hymn, Amazing Grace. It will be posted up on the worship screens if you'd like. The music to it can be found in the red hymnals, hymn 379.
Thank you.
Praise to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who comforts us in all our troubles, so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves have received from God. The Apostle Paul writes to the Romans, "The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord." Jesus gives us this comfort. "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even though he dies. Whoever lives and believes in me will never die." Death has been swallowed up in victory. Thanks be to God.
He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ.
When Christ, who is our life, appears,
then we also will appear with him in glory.
We will be before the throne of God
and serve him day and night in his temple.
Never again will we hunger.
Never again will we thirst.
For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be our shepherd. He will lead us to springs of living water.
And God will wipe away every tear from our eyes.
We pray. God of all grace, you sent your Son Jesus to destroy the power of death and to open the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Make us certain that because he lives, we too shall live. Comfort us with your promise that neither death nor life nor things present nor things to come shall be able to separate us from your love, which is in Christ Jesus, our Lord.
Amen.
Our first lesson of comfort from God's word comes from 1 Peter chapter 5. Here we'll look at verse 7 going through verse 10. And it's a section I shared with some of the family last Saturday, but it's a section I also oftentimes shared with Gladys. A section that really is God just simply telling us not to be anxious about all the things we can so easily become anxious about, not to be troubled by all the things that can so easily trouble us, by what we hear and what we see going on in this world. But it simply directs us to God's voice and reminds us why we can hear that voice and have every confidence because of what it tells us. We listen as God speaks to us through his word. "Cast all your anxiety on him because he cares for you. Have sound judgment. Be alert. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Resist him by being firm in the faith. You know that the same kinds of suffering are being laid on your brotherhood all over the world. After you have suffered a little while, the God of all grace, who called you into his eternal glory in Christ Jesus, will himself restore, establish, strengthen, and support you. To him be the glory and the power forever and ever. Amen." Out of respect for the words and works of Jesus found in the gospel reading, please stand. Our gospel lesson today, as we say our goodbyes to Gladys and also give thanks to God for what he accomplished through and in her, comes from the gospel according to John, looking at chapter 14, where we'll focus on verses 1 through 7 and 25 through 27. Here Jesus speaks to you and to me, encouraging us not to be troubled, encouraging us simply to hear him and to know that the peace he came to give is yours, just as it is mine, just as it was Gladys's and is right now in full. And may we listen as God proclaims that peace to you and to me. "Do not let your heart be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to be with me, so that you may also be where I am. You know where I am going, and you know the way." "Lord, we don't know where you are going," Thomas replied. So how can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you would also know my Father. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. I have told you these things while staying with you. But the Counselor, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and remind you of everything I told you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, do I give to you. Do not let your heart be troubled. Do not let it be afraid. Please be seated. We'll continue with our next hymn, hymn 411, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. Message with prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, as we gather in your house this morning, may we simply hear your voice so that the peace that Gladys knows right now in full is also the peace that we may know by simply hearing the peace that you proclaim and the truth that you give to us in your word. I boldly ask that you would use me, your humble servant, to simply and clearly proclaim this truth so that all of us may be comforted and encouraged by it. We ask this in the name of our living and reigning Savior Jesus. Amen. Dear friends, and especially you, family of Gladys, death has sort of an interesting impact on everyone, most everyone. It sort of has a way of, in a way, making us think about life. We look back on the life that the individual lived, and we kind of look through it with all the different pictures and recalling of all the different memories. Lots of happiness that can come from those things. Has us looking back on that life that the individual lived and what made them special, what made them unique, what they were able to do and to see, family that they made. We think about all these things that they did and their accomplishments and who they were, often allowing the best to sort of bubble to the surface and even allowing maybe the things that caused us to struggle with them just a little bit to be seen with a little bit of a fondness. Because it's what made that individual them. But it usually doesn't stop there. If we're honest, it can also have an impact on our own lives. We can think about our life. Maybe it even causes us to think about getting our things in order or how we should, that we should, something that we should do at some point, get our things in order. It can leave us contemplating the legacy that we live, the memories that we maybe make and leave for others to think about. Maybe it causes us to make changes in our own life, knowing and remembering that life is not short. Maybe it reminds us to go and visit that person we haven't visited in a while, call them, talk to them. In short, our minds really don't like to focus a whole lot on death. But life. Life both of the individual who died, and then the life that we have right now. And obviously, those things are great and good things. It's good to be thankful for a life that God has blessed us with. It's good to appreciate the blessings that that life brought. It's good to, in turn, reflect on the gift of life that God has given to us and how to make the best use of it. How to reflect on those things that maybe we could do better, or to think about the things that we have to work on during the time that we have been given. But what's also true is that sometimes we can get maybe so focused on those things that we can sort of turn our ears away from hearing what God has to say about life and almost more develop a in-the-moment thought on, I better get to living. And just focus on my happiness. Specifically, sometimes tuning out what God has to say on the topic and also what death itself has to say on the topic with its powerful preaching that it gives to us. It's a life-changing thing. And that's why today as we gather in God's house to praise Him, not just for the life that He gave to Gladys, the faith that He worked in her heart to know Him. God directs us not just to think differently, but also to hear differently. To hear as Gladys hears. And I pray that as we look to accomplish both of those things, we can do so by turning to God's Word found in John chapter 5. We'll read through verses 22 through 25, especially focusing on the last two verses, 24 and 25. In fact, the Father judges no one, but has entrusted all judgment to the Son, so that all should honor the Son just as they honor the Father. Whoever does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent Him. Amen, amen, I tell you. Anyone who hears my word and believes Him who sent me has eternal life. He is not going to come into judgment, but has crossed over from death to life. Amen, amen, I tell you. A time is coming and is here now when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who listen will live. In the background of this lesson, Jesus is facing death. But not the death that maybe we so often think about when it comes to Jesus' death, but The Jews at that time were plotting, actively plotting, to kill him, and were kind of actually even ramping up those plots because he spoke of his equality with God the Father. Namely, the fact that he was the promised Messiah, and they did not want to hear that. But that doesn't stop Jesus from proclaiming the truth, because the truth was that important and his time had not yet come. And so he's proclaiming very actively and clearly who he is. And so in our lesson, we sort of have this bold teaching because of that from Jesus about giving equal honor to God the Father and himself. And as the lesson goes on, he tells us why that's true. As the verses that we're especially focusing on proclaim to us. There Jesus gives the why. Jesus proclaims the power his word has on an individual. He tells you and me that the one who hears his word and believes the one who sent him has eternal life. It is their possession that they hold right then. Then adding clarity to what he means, Jesus sort of restates it. Says the same thing in a little bit different way. He says the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who listen will live. He leaves absolutely zero room for doubt. There's no doubt in Jesus' words. There's no room for them to mean something other than what they clearly state. They are words of comfort because they're words of certainty. Proclaims life. And brothers and sisters in faith, family and friends of Gladys, that is the voice that Gladys hears right now with her own ears. She hears the one who proclaimed from the cross, "It is finished." And she sees in full how he was talking to her. She hears the one, the very voice of the one who promised that he is with her always. The one who never left her room, her side, her bed. And she sees how he kept that promise perfectly. She hears the voice of the one who promised her, "Because I live, you also will live." She lives, and she lives to the fullest. The Bible tells us what that means, that her life is no longer defined by aches and pains, but what she needs to do before it's too late. There's no longer that person that she needs to visit because who knows what may happen down the road. She lives life as God intended life to be, void of pain, void of sadness, void of loss, void of any type of unhappiness, void of the fear of even the hint of death. It is a life purely defined exactly by that life. There's no more dying involved. There's no more missing involved. She lives because by God's grace, Jesus paid the full load of the judgment she deserved for her, and so there is none left for her. There's nothing left for her except to know the fullness of joy that can only be known by falling asleep in faith and being awakened to the voice of her Savior, saying, "Come, you who are blessed by my Father, receive your inheritance." I hope and pray that is a comfort for all who have gathered here to say goodbye to Gladys. A comfort founded not in the words of a sinful person, comfort that does not come from my thoughts or just what I think to be true, but from the very word of God. But if that is all that we said this morning, today, we truly would not be listening to, at least completely, what Gladys is listening to right now. We would not be listening to what God would have us listen to, and that's because there is nothing that I can say that will change or affect or make better what Gladys is seeing and living and hearing right now. But there is something we can listen to so that we are encouraged, so that we are strengthened, so that we are made more confident as we are left to press on the time that we have been given during our walk of faith. And that's true because the exact same voice that Gladys hears right now with her own ears is also the same voice which has given us God's word. The words we are looking at from John 5. And Jesus clearly tells us here in John 5 who this is for, and so I can confidently speak this to all of us. That it is for anyone. There is nothing that anyone can think or say or do that negates these words, that makes them any less true than what they are, because they're not the words of a sinner. They're not the words of one who is not able to even add a second, a moment to their life. They're the words of the one who gives life. They're the words of the one who authored life. They're the words of the one who defines it, the one who created it. They are words filled with power and confidence. There is no maybes, no mights, no hopefuls to them. See, death makes us contemplate life because it's not fun. It's not enjoyable to focus on death. It's filled with uncertainty. How it will happen, what it will look like, what it will feel like. Maybe for some, what's waiting after it. And the truth is that any human thought about it, any thought that comes from a person, is just that, from a person. A person who has no power over it, a person who has no power to say when it will come, a person who is subject to death because every person is born in sin and lives in sin. As we were reminded earlier in our service, God tells us clearly, that's the reason for death. The wages of sin. But Jesus came to give forgiveness. Jesus came to take our sin upon himself, just as he took Gladys's to be sin's payment for us. He came to destroy sin's hold on us, its control over us. That's why his victory also needed to be over death. And that's exactly what he accomplished. As he rose from the dead, showing its weakness, and showing his control over it. And that's why he has the authority to say, and to tell you and me, what it does. And what it doesn't do. It's not the end. He makes it give you life. That's why only he can make it do what he wants, and only he can make the promises he does, and why those promises are his to offer, his to give to you and to me, and why there's power behind them and truth behind them. So today, it's my prayer, I hope it's also yours, that our mourning, our reflection, our thoughts, and our confidence would be influenced by the voice that Gladys hears. This morning, today, we hear the same thing. We hear God speak his confidence to us. And we hear that it is addressed to each of us as well. And it's then that we can smile through sadness. It's then that we can praise our God. It's then that we can be reassured and reminded that death is not the end. It's not the period on your life. It's the beginning of a real world. God's voice tells you so. Jesus conquered death, and so with his voice he can and he will make those who fall asleep in death, those who fall asleep knowing and having listened to his voice, having faith in his promises, he can and he will give life. Life that is perfect, life that is eternally living. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, may it be yours through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. We continue our worship today, confessing the faith that Gladys knew and confessed herself, using the words of the Apostles' Creed. We confess. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We pray, and following the prayer of the church, the congregation is asked to also join in as you like with the Lord's Prayer. O Father of mercies and God of all comfort, in this hour of sorrow we implore your grace to enable us to say in humble submission, your will be done. While our hearts are filled with sadness at the death of our loved one, yet our lips speak praise that you have removed her from all the trials and tribulations of this life and received her to yourself in heaven. Sustain us by the power of your holy word, which promises strength and help in time of need. Comfort us with the precious hope of the resurrection of the body and the life everlasting through Jesus Christ our Lord, in whose name we also join in praying the prayer he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, but trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now hear with believing hearts the blessing of your God. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen. We'll close our worship with our final hymn, Precious Lord, Take My Hand. Thank you. Gladys June Shelley was born August 14, 1928, on the family farm in Paxton Township, Redwood County, Minnesota, to John and Margaret Jacobson. She graduated from Morton High School and attended the University of Minnesota School of Agriculture. She worked at Citizen State Bank in the Ford Garage in Redwood Falls. April 23, 1950, she married Ervey Shelley in Morton, Minnesota. They lived in Redwood Falls, New Ulm and Cambridge. She worked at St. Paul's Lutheran Church in New Ulm, the Cambridge Clinic, Isanti County Highway Department, and as a freelance artist. Gladys enjoyed taking art classes in Minnesota and Iowa, as well as in Switzerland and the Netherlands. She enjoyed teaching painting classes, wood carving, displaying and selling her artwork throughout Minnesota and neighboring states. Her family will remember her for her apple pies and elephant cinnamon rolls, in addition to her artwork. She was proud of her Norwegian heritage, American Legion Auxiliary membership, and Lutheran Church affiliation. Gladys passed away March 12, 2022, at Gracepoint Crossing in Cambridge at the age of 93 years, 6 months, and 26 days. She was preceded in death by her parents, husband Ervey, brothers Harold, Clarence, Elmer, and John Jr., sisters Margaret and Norma. This time, I ask the congregation to please stand for the recessional. Following that, the whole family would like to invite the congregation to a light lunch as well.